I want to preach a message this morning for Father's Day. And I want to preach a message not to beat you up. I don't want to abuse you. However, I do want to challenge you, encourage you. And I want to make sure that you get challenged. Now listen, I'm going to leave all the ruffles and the fluff away. That stuff is saved for Mother's Day. But today's Father's Day. And I want to challenge you with the word from the Lord. I want to preach a message that I've called a lost heritage. A lost heritage. If you have your Bibles, turn to the book of Judges, chapter 2. It says on the screen, verse 7, but I want to begin reading at verse number 6. Everybody found Judges, chapter 2, verse number 6. And when Joshua had let the people go, the children of Israel went every man unto his inheritance to possess the land. And the people served the Lord all the days of Joshua and all the days of the elders that outlived Joshua. Now listen to this line right here. All the days of the elders that outlived Joshua, who had seen all the great works of the Lord that he did for Israel. And Joshua, the son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died, being 110 years old. And they buried him in the border of his inheritance. And also all that generation were gathered unto their fathers, and there arose another generation after them, which knew not the Lord, nor yet the works which he had done for Israel. And the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord, and they served Balaam. And they forsook the Lord God of their fathers, which brought them out of the land of Egypt, and followed their other gods, of the gods of the people that were around about them. And they bowed themselves unto them, and provoked the Lord to anger. Verse 13 says, and the Lord forsook them and served, they forsook the Lord and served Balaam and Ashtoreth. And the anger of the Lord was hot against Israel. And he delivered them into the hands of spoilers and spoiled them. And he sold them into the hands of their enemies round about, so that they could not any longer stand before their enemies. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for this service that's been such a blessing so far. And I thank you, God, for the anointed singing, the specials, the praise team, the congregationals, the wonderful atmosphere for fathers. But now, God, we need a word from you. We've got to have a word to challenge us, a word to rebuke us, a word to convict us. And I ask you to send that word today in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
In our text, we see a very sad occasion occurring. Joshua has died. But in his honor, I want to mention a few things about Joshua, because the Bible records that Joshua, while he was alive, he led people to serve the Lord and to follow the ways of the Lord. And I hope that that will be the testimonies of the fathers in this room. As a matter of fact, I hope that will be testimonies of the women in the room as well, that those in our lives and those in our families will serve the Lord with all their hearts for all their lives. Listen, men, you need to understand there is power in the Father's influence.
Yes.
There is such great power in the Father's influence. And I need to tell you first thing this morning that you have so much influence not only over your children but over your whole household.
Amen.
You do not need to take that influence lightly.
Amen.
Do not underestimate the power of a father.
Amen.
Joshua was a great leader. He was strong and courageous. He had great enthusiasm for the vision and the promise of God. Joshua follows the orders of God and he conquers the promised land. Joshua was faithful to the promise of God and to the covenant of God. Man, what an awesome testimony about Joshua at the age of 110 that we can say that he goes to the grave with a completed life knowing that he was faithful to follow God. And I pray that as leaders in our families and leaders in our church, we will be like Joshua. Amen?
Amen.
I hope that we can say like Joshua in Joshua 24 verse 15. And it says, and if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom you will serve, whether the gods which your fathers served that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in those land, in whose land we dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord.
Amen.
Can I tell you, it's time for fathers to make a declaration. It's time for every dad in this room, whether your kids are grown or whether your kids are in diapers, it's time that you decide to be a father and say, you know what? I don't care if you serve the gods of this world. I don't care what the people around me are doing.
Right.
I don't care if they're going against Jehovah or if they're believing in Jehovah. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. I'm going to make a declaration today. As for me and my house, as the father, as the head of the family, as the priest of my home, I'm going to speak on behalf of every child and every grandchild and great-grand-grandchild people. We're going to be courageous and we'll seize the promises of God. Right. And it's not going to be just me. I declare it over my son and over my daughters. We Amen. Will serve the Lord.
Amen.
I'm going to leave a heritage for my children to live in. I'm going to leave a heritage for my children to rely on. But in our text, we see where Joshua has died, as I mentioned, at an age of 110. And one by one, the people of that generation begin to die off. One by one, they begin to die off. And here, and when I was reading the text, I said, I want you to hear something. One by one, those people who saw the works of God begin to die off. One by one, those that saw the awesome miracles of God and saw the works upon Joshua and how God blessed, one by one, those people began to die off. The people that had visible proof, I'm going somewhere with this morning, the people that had visible proof that God was God began to die off.
Yes.
Now let me ask you a question before I go any further. Are we leaving a heritage for future generations? Or are we losing the generations of children? Are we going to lose this generation? A strong group right now that's faithful, strong, and anointed. Will the young people of this church be lost or will they be kept? And it will be because fathers are taking a Joshua stand as a spiritual leader. Or it's because fathers will not take a Joshua stand and declare, we will serve the Lord. The generation after Joshua didn't know. They didn't know the power of God. Now listen, it's not that they didn't have the teachings of the gospel or the teachings of the Torah. They had the word. Yeah. They had the things that have been passed down. They had the prophecies that have gone before them. But the difference was from them and the people, right, the generation of Joshua, was that the new generation did not see the awesome hand of God in their lives. Right. They had heard about it, but they had not experienced it. Can I tell you, it is important that at the Rising Fall Church of God, yes, our babies and our teenagers not only hear about it, but see a demonstration of the great power of God. They need to know. Our children need to know that God is a healer, that God is a deliverer. Let them not grow up not knowing the power of God. Let our children not grow up never experiencing the anointing and the power of the Holy Ghost. Let them never grow up and say, I never saw somebody get healed, and I right. never saw a miracle, and I never saw a demonstration of the Holy Ghost. No, yes. Not here. Let the power of God raise you up. Our children need to know what is preached from the Bible is real because they have visible proof.
Amen.
We must decide and commit to teach our children and future generations of the greatness of God. We must be willing to allow our future generations to see the greatness of God. They must hear His statutes. They must hear His commands. And it is our responsibility to teach them that it's their responsibility to obey God's word.
Yes.
Let them see the power of God working in their life. But we've got to decide to be a man. Yes. We've got to decide to be a man. We must stand firm and courageous and be the men that God has called us to be.
Amen.
We must become the leaders and the priests of our homes. And
right.
We must become the heads of our families.
Yeah.
And to borrow an old country phrase, we must wear the pants in our house. It is time for men to be men.
Yeah.
Godly, righteous,
yeah.
holy,
yeah.
sanctified,
yes.
powerful,
yeah.
anointed
yeah.
men. Let
yeah.
men of this church
yeah.
become men.
Yeah. Amen.
Yes, Lord. Be a man. 1 Kings chapter 2, verse 1, listen to what happens here. Now the days of David drew nigh that he should die, and he charged Solomon, saying, I go the way of all the earth. Be thou strong before, therefore, and show thyself a man. One translation says Solomon leaned over to David, or David leaned over to David, and David said, son, be a man. Keep the charge of the Lord thy God to walk in His ways. Keep His statutes and His commandments and His judgments and His testimonies. As it is written in the law of Moses, that thou mayest prosper in all that you do, and whithersoever thou turnest thyself, that the Lord may continue in His word which He spake concerning me, saying, if thy children take heed to their way to walk before me in truth with all their heart and with all their soul, there shall not fail thee, said he, a man on the throne of Israel. David says, hey son, be a man.
Yes.
And here's what he says. There's four things in being a man you got to do. Walk in the way of God. Number
Amen.
One.
Amen.
If you're going to be a man, walk in the way of God. The Bible is a light unto your path. The Word of God ought to order your steps. If you're going to be a man in the current society, you're going to have to walk in the way of God. That means you're not influenced by political correctness. You're not influenced by the ways of government. You're not influenced by the ways of television stars. You're not influenced by the ways of internet sensations. You are influenced by thus saith the Word of God. If you're going to be the man that is going to influence your family, if you're going to be a man that will influence a whole generation, then you must walk in the way of God. Amen. Number two, David commanded Saul, keep his word. As a matter of fact, he says, keep his statutes, his testimonies, keep his law. And listen, it is better to obey than to sacrifice. Not only are we going to walk in the way of God, which means he's going to lead us, he's going to guide us, he's going to direct us, but we're going to be obedient to whatever this word says. And the word does not change. You can look up debate after debate after debate on the internet. You can get on YouTube and they'll debate that this world, the word of God is irrelevant. They'll debate that this is not intended for the modern society, that the word ought to change to be able to fit today. But I still stand on the oath that we ought to change to fit the word. The word was good yesterday, it'll be good tomorrow, and it'll be good the next day. It is still the word of God. If you're going to be a man that will allow a future generation to have power, then you're going to keep the word of God. You're going to be obedient to its commands, not just the Ten Commandments, but the many commands found from Genesis to Revelation. You're going to commit yourself to doing what God tells you to do. Amen. Thirdly, if you're going to be a man, you're going to have to walk in obedience, and you're going to have to realize your obedience leads to blessing.
Yes.
Amen. I love that song. And that one of the lines in the song, James said, I've tried to fill this empty space. And cars and fame and all of this money. But there's a hollow space in the shape of a God in my life.
Yes, sir. Amen.
Don't you understand it? Your blessings do not come from the riches of the world. It doesn't come from the fame. It doesn't come from promotions on your job. It doesn't come by having bigger houses and better cars. It doesn't come because everybody sees you wearing tailored suits and you got the designer jeans on. No. Your obedience will lead to your blessing.
Yes,
some of you are not being blessed in the ways of God. You may flourish in the ways of the world, and you may have more money in your bank account, which I do. However, that might not mean that you're walking in the divine blessing of God's favor in your life. If you're going to walk in God's favor, you have to obey the word of God. Your obedience will lead you to your blessings.
Yes.
And then I love what David said to Solomon. Son, let his word continue. Whatever we do, don't silence the voice of God.
Amen.
We cannot be satisfied with some other form of God's voice. We cannot be satisfied relying on what used to be and what used to happen and what used to be said. We must say, God, let your word continue. Give me a fresh vision and a fresh word. Give me a fresh anointing. God, I need the power, the anointing to continue. Oh, God, let the words continue to flow from heaven down to this earth and into my life. God, please let your word continue.
Yes, Lord.
As soon as you begin to silence the voice of God in your life, as soon as you begin to silence the voice of God in your church, your obedience will stop, you'll fall, and you'll move out of blessings into curses. You have to allow the voice of God to continue. Can I charge you this morning, be a man. We cannot lose a generation. We must influence our sons, and we must influence our daughters to remain in God. Let me ask you, how's your influence, Daddy? How's your heritage? Is your heritage going to be lost?
Mom.
Let me close this morning by asking you a very important question. Do you really care about your children's future? Or are you only concerned about yours? Do you really care? Let's look at this verse, 2 Kings chapter 20. And of thy sons that shall issue from thee, which thou shalt begot, which thou hast begot, shall they take away, and they shall be eunuchs in the palace of the king of Babylon. Then listen to what Hezekiah says. Hezekiah says to Isaiah, good is the word of the Lord which you've spoken to me. And he said, is it not good if peace and truth be in my days? Let me break this down for a second. Isaiah's message of judgment came upon Hezekiah. And it wasn't for Hezekiah, it was for his children and his grandchildren, for future generations.
Third and fourth.
His future sons were going to be taken captive. His future grandchildren would be eunuchs and held in bondage, servant to a foreign king. The current day may have peace, but not your sons, Hezekiah. And listen to what he says in a different translation. This is the New Living Translation. Kind of breaks it down. Hezekiah said to Isaiah, "This message you've given me from the Lord is good." For the king was thinking, at least there's going to be peace and security during my lifetime. Do you care? Do you really care? Hezekiah seemed to care for his peace, but not the peace of his children. Hezekiah seemed to care about his blessings and his sufficiency, but yet not the sufficiency of his kids. I wonder how many fathers are in this church and that will watch this through the internet. I wonder how many fathers are more concerned with their life and not the future of their children.
Amen.
Are we so consumed with our own peace and luxury that we're creating bondage for future generations? I mean, just take a look at our government. Brother Bain and I were talking about this earlier this week. It's pretty obvious that we don't really care as a nation about our children and our grandchildren and our great-grandchildren by running up a national debt that we'll never be able to pay off, as if we're now into the trillions and trillions of dollars. And it doesn't matter. We're going to rob everything we have from future generations so we can be happy. And unfortunately, that mentality is in the church just like it's in government. As long as I can have a big house, as long as I can get mine, I'm not worried about what my children have. As long as I can walk in my peace, it doesn't matter about what my kids have. We need to change that line of thinking.
Amen.
You do matter. Your influence on your generations to come matters in your life.
Yes.
Amen.
Is your current lifestyle creating a lasting legacy? Are you creating a heritage of holiness and righteousness? Or are you creating a prison of bondage for your children and your grandchildren? That's a hard thought to think on. Well, it don't matter about my kids. I'm going to feed them right now. It doesn't matter about my actions. It doesn't matter about what I'm going to do in my life. Yes, it does.
Yes.
Are you cursing your future generations?
Amen.
It's time for you to influence your children.
Yes.
And in order to do that, Sister Sandra, and in order to do that, you've got to check your priorities.
Amen.
You've got to be a man. Leave a legacy for your children and their children too. You need to think about the four things I mentioned. Are you walking in the way of God? Are you keeping His word? Do you realize that your obedience to Christ leads to your blessings? Is His word going to continue in your life? Are you being a man according to what the Bible says a man is? Doesn't mean that you have big muscles and thick beards and nice curly hair. It means that you are a godly man.
Amen.
A man that impacts his children and his grandchildren. A generation normally is about 40 years. That means you're impacting not just this generation,
right,
but for 40 years your legacy is going to trickle down to kids and grandkids and great-grandkids because you took a stand for God.
Amen.
Yes, amen.
You need to check your priorities.
Yes.
It's Father's Day. Happy Father's Day.
Mm-hmm.
Hope I haven't been too mean on you. But listen. See, here's the thing. In the Church of God, the women, throughout, since I've been in the Church of God, women kept the church alive in the early days. At the very beginning, I'm sure the men kept the church going, because when you read the Church of God history, you read about the men of the church. But then somewhere the men quit coming and the ladies saw the ladies' auxiliary team. The ladies' ministry band began to sell donuts and sell peanut brittle and sell cakes, and they did everything they could to keep their little churches open. And as a result, the Church of God lost influence for a season because the men were not taking over their families.
That's right.
We cannot allow the ladies to try to be the leader of our spiritual house. That's the man's job.
Yes.
Women, you ought to take security in that. It's not a woman's job to have to grab hold. And listen, women ought to pray too.
Right.
But it's the man's job to grab hold of that horn of that altar and pray until a breakthrough happens in their family.
Amen.
And greater is the anointing when that husband and wife can join together in unity and pray
with
the horn of the altars. But men, it is your responsibility to be the priest of your home.
Right.
You've got to be a man.
Amen.
Because you're influencing generations to come.
Yes.
Are you leading them to bondage? Or are you leading them into a land that flows with milk and honey? That decision. decisions up to you. I hope you'll do what's right in the eyes of God. Let's stand.